Welcome to Lucha TV. We've got another episode today on spectrophotometry. I'm Julianne Martin. I'm a senior process engineer here at Lucha, and I've got John Church with me, who's the principal process engineer, and Luis Ortenzio, who is our chief engineer. So for people that don't know much about spectrophotometry, just really quickly, it's about measuring the absorbance of light and chemical compounds. So for water and wastewater treatment, you have an instrument called a spectrometer, and you shine light through and then you look at the absorbance pattern, and you can make inferences about what's in your sample and what kind of concentrations there are. So one of the uses that we've developed for this here at Lutra is our Compass coagulant controller. So we use it on water and wastewater treatment plants. So water plants, we're measuring the organics in the water, and then together with turbidity we come up with a coagulant dose. Wastewater plants, we developed a surrogate for phosphorus in the wastewater, so you can use that at the back end of the plant, polishing the final effluent before it gets discharged. And the advantages of that is you can react much quicker to changes in the water or the wastewater, so you can ramp up your chemical dose and you ramp it down again when you need to. But today we really kind of wanted to talk about new uses for spectrometers, and which is why I've got John and Lewis here. So I don't know, John, do you want to start with some water uses for us?
Yeah, sure. So spectrophotometers, as Julianne mentioned, can pick up various different compounds that have got certain absorbances at certain wavelengths. So an area that they're not often used for, at least in New Zealand yet, is picking up various things that you would not think you might necessarily want to detect for. I say things that you wouldn't necessarily want, because usually what people measure with these things is they'll be measuring, say, the UV absorbance, maybe some specific wavelengths for nitrate, TOC, DOC, that kind of thing. But what they can also be used for is directly picking up, say, parameters of concern. So for instance, if you have a significant occurrence of, say, a diesel spill in the raw water, then a spectrophotometer will be able to determine that there's a particular absorbance that's being blocked by this material, and therefore you can react to it. If you've got it set up this way to essentially alarm you of this type of contamination. You can use the spectros for anything that you can get your hands on, basically, that might be a gross pollutant to alarm you in those kind of events. But what is a really interesting and emerging use for them is to use them to infer the presence of things which you might not necessarily be able to directly detect with them. And what I mean by that is, for instance, in the case of, say, an algal bloom in a raw water source, that can produce taste and odor compounds, it can produce potentially cyanotoxins, but both of these are at levels which are very, very small, in the micron nanogram sort of level. So the spectro, no matter how good it is, unless it was a laboratory-based million-dollar instrument, probably won't be able to detect any absorbance for it. But what it can potentially detect is the changes that are occurring in the raw water source. So for instance, if the raw water character, the character essentially meaning the types of organic molecules that are in the raw water, change due to the presence of an algal bloom, for instance, in a certain way that reflects an algal bloom, then you will at least know that that is occurring in your source. And potentially that can tell you via essentially a surrogate that you have an increased risk of cyanotoxin or, say, taste and odor compounds. And additionally, of course, you may be able to pick up things like the micropollutants, the kind of things that are in groundwater these days, like the PFAS and microplastics. Again, they may not necessarily be there because of a direct measurement, because the concentration is too small, but they may be present through a surrogate representation from other measurements on other wavelengths that basically imply that they're present. So it's an emerging area because nobody yet has really done much work testing these sort of things in a lab and finding out exactly what they mean. So,
When you talk about surrogates, for things like algae, the presence of algae. Are you thinking that's like something you can develop that could be for any place, any particular source, or would you think it's going to be site specific?
Well, that's a very interesting question. So yeah, that within itself is something that will have to be worked out, because obviously algae being a great one, and even taking it a step back, say the raw water character, just purely the type of organics in rivers and streams in New Zealand, it changes massively from place to place. But there are some general rules about, you know, for instance, with our compass system, about how much coagulant you can dose for a given type of raw water. So there may be analogies between different water sources, or they may be site specific. I guess the answer is we don't know at this point. But I would hope that things like the presence of algae should be inferable through some sort of common compound or change or whatever it is that's in the water.
Yeah, that's interesting. What about wastewater?
Yeah, so on the wastewater side, along with a lot of the surrogate stuff that John was talking about, there are always new surrogates to be developing on the wastewater side. We're looking into detecting polymer residual. And so there's a lot of global research that's been done in the last 5 or 10 years around detecting polymer residual in water using UV-Vis. And so we're kind of leveraging off of that research to try and develop good ways to detect polymer residual in dewatering centrate and filtrate. So what this allows us to do is to look and see whether we're overdosing or underdosing polymer based on the quality and the absorbance of the centrate or the filtrate, and then optimize that and potentially do that in real time.
And so that has the potential to save a lot of money on polymer?
Yeah, for large plants, it can save something like $500,000 to $1 million in polymer. Okay. Just depends on the size of the plant.
Yeah.
But yeah, I think it's pretty safe to say that most plants overdose polymer, because it's easy. It makes operations easy.
Yeah.
Set and forget.
Yeah.
Yeah. Similar to compass coagulation.
Yeah. So a real-time controller would be quite beneficial.
Mm. Yeah. Yeah, because I think it's interesting to think about that, because that translates into a direct monetary saving.
Whereas a lot of the stuff you're talking about is risk.
Is risk, yeah. It's more esoteric, more ethereal, but at least it comes, at least from my perspective, being a water engineer, back to, you know, understanding your water source and being able to recognize change, because we have a lot of parameters that we measure in water, and some of them change due to various things all the time, but there's a lot of things which are important, be it pollutant or algae or whatever it happens to be, for a water source, where it's very difficult to detect a change without actually physically seeing it. And that includes things like diesel spills. You may not know until it's already being tasted by somebody. So, yeah. So that is difficult to put into a monetary value, but if you look at it from a risk perspective, it could be quite large.
One of the barriers that I thought a few years ago was kind of the cost of these instruments, and just wondering if the price coming down recently, technology developments?
So it definitely has come down recently, and part of that is due to various new suppliers, or maybe old suppliers offering new equipment. Better competition in the market, more options available to people, and also the technology is getting more mature. You know, maybe 10 years ago it was you could still buy it, but it was the kind of thing that was perhaps more niche use rather than common, something that you might commonly see.
I think you would call, from a supplier standpoint, you would see it as proprietary.
Mm, yes.
So that when something's proprietary, obviously it comes with a price tag, because there's a lot more IP built into that. So because that IP is more well understood across the water, wastewater industry, you have more competition, and that drives price down.
Yeah, yeah.
So these units are becoming much more competitive and much more affordable compared to where they were 5 years ago.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, indeed.
Cool. All right, thanks for that. That was a really interesting topic. Obviously, it's a big one again. If there's anything else that people want to know or interested to keep talking about these things, please feel free to get in touch with Lutra. And thanks for watching.